And government, don't put your hand into the basket when the basket is working very well. Thank you.
陳志全議員.
主席.
Mr. Ray Chan, Madam Deputy, we should step up regulation of listed companies. It should be done, and it's worth our while. And it should be for a statutory organization to do the gatekeeping in order to safeguard Hong Kong's status as an international financial center. In recent years, there have been many problems with newly listed companies. I believe most of them have come from the mainland, and they have this characteristic, and that is in the IPO financial report, it is said that it has had three-year double-digit growth. But then after listing for 1 year, its profits would go down, and many would issue profit warnings. Like in 2015, amongst the IPOs, 15% of them issued profit warnings. And on GEM, 29% of IPO companies issued profit warnings. And there was one company that issued a profit warning 2 months into listing. And some have to suspend trading for a long, long time, and investors have lost all their monies. In June 2014, there is this mainland company. The market capitalization was $6.3 billion. But after 3 months, it is said that the profits were hugely exaggerated and the target price should be zero. And in September, the company was suspended until now. It has been suspended longer than it having been listed. There is funding to the billions from individual investors which has been frozen. And the public would have to ask, why is it that the SFC and Hong Kong X cannot discover that about half of the new IPO companies have whitewashed their accounts? Why is it that the sponsors have not been able to discover the problems before IPO? IPO sponsors should be the gatekeepers, and SFC and Hong Kong X should supervise the sponsors and also the quality of IPOs. But in recent years, many sponsors, including those from the mainland, overseas, and Hong Kong, they have not done their part in securing the quality of IPO, apart from Credit Suisse and Standard Chartered, which are inquired into in many past years. In the past, the SFC only rebutted one or vetoed one listing application. Why is it that there is actually no supervision on the IPO sponsors? It is because most of the work is done by the Hong Kong X, and Hong Kong X has a lot of conflicts with any listing matter. If a company can be listed, then Hong Kong X has more revenue. Therefore, there is incentive for the Hong Kong X to turn a blind eye to problematic listing applications. If there will be more supervision, then perhaps a big number of mainland enterprises cannot be listed in Hong Kong, and the Hong Kong X will have much less listing fees. If there will be more supervision, and if there is a reduction in the number of successful listing applications, then the dealers will also have fewer or less profit. This is so easy to understand. When there is actually no regulation and regulatory regime, the sponsors can still underwrite and promote new IPOs, which may be problematic. And in order to get more mainland business, they may engage people who are closely related to these mainland enterprises to become high-ranking officials in sponsors. For example, recently, someone was engaging the daughter of a director of a company that was to be listed so that the sponsor will get the business. And the sponsor may exaggerate the IPO capitalization, and also you can get a few so-called actors in the industry to help promote the IPO. And then afterwards, if it is suspended, the sponsors go free. In the end, only the small investors will lose all their money, and the sponsor, the Hong Kong X, and even the dealers or security firms can still enjoy and pocket huge listing fees. There are so many stories of this sort. But then there is this special characteristic of small investors in Hong Kong. They are forgetful. They are like punters. There has been many IPO problems, but small investors still are tempted, and they are still trapped by these near deception cases. Therefore, Hong Kong X, which has serious conflict of interest, if it continues to take care of listing applications, it is very difficult for it to protect the interests of small investors. I believe there should be a statutory body to vet listing applications so we can deal with this problem of conflict of interest. I would also say that the statutory body should be supported to a larger extent. They should be able to go to the mainland to investigate problematic IPOs, so these IPOs should not take place in Hong Kong. Today, Mr. Christopher Cheung's motion, as I heard from Edward Yu, I think Edward Yu has a point to make. This, it says actively promote financial innovation. Well, financial innovation, of course, can make money for many people because if you, for example, vitalize the economy, well, whether it is the real economy or a bubble economy, we don't know. And in the end, again, is the small investors who are going to lose. So in the end, they may lose all the money if they don't put the money in the bank for a meager interest. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, Mr. Christopher Cheung would like us to speak to support him. Well, this is simple. We are discussing financial matters of Hong Kong here in the chamber. Donald Zhang's family, of course, is totally involved in this business. I actually already pointed out that Hong Kong's economy is a casino economy. What is a casino economy? Somebody operates a casino, is a zero-sum game. Certainly, the operator stands to gain. The Hong Kong X is the operator of the casino. Frankly speaking, you go to Macau, you go to Lisboa. Well, I cannot go to Macau. I don't know how many casinos there are. But as long as there are people going to the casinos, you get a fee from them whenever they enter. The Hong Kong X is a listed company. Its performance, of course, is its business turnover. So frankly speaking, there is the incentive of allowing more listings. As long as more people come to gamble and more frequently, then it stands to gain. Reuters only reports matters, and of course its reports are important. There is the stipulation that it cannot be listed, and it cannot conduct any other business in the market. So that's fair, right? It's only reporting news. The Reuters would let us know the market situation, and it must be accurate and fair. Let us look at Hong Kong X. Hong Kong X operates a casino. It then invents many gambling methods. A friend asked me, what should I buy? And I said, MTRCL, Hong Kong X, and also Link. This is a no-lose package. Of course, if Hong Kong X doesn't operate well and the price drops, then my friend will lose everything. But this is the problem. We can see this happening. The administration deliberately lists Hong Kong X so that there will be an incentive for Hong Kong X to operate a casino itself and for it to be selling different gambling methods to people. This is like derivatives. The banks have nothing better to do. In 2008, there was the financial tsunami. Before 2008, the banks had nothing better to do. So it tried also to deal in securities. It underwrites the securities trading, and then consumers have to fend for themselves without the banks taking any responsibility. Mr. President, when we vetted the packaging of derivatives, only disclosure was required. As long as you tell the truth, when there is disclosure, the derivatives can change its nature the next day. And then we asked why the banks did not watch over the situation. The banks said, those are products, and they have been sold. It is not a kind of investment, and we have nothing to do with the securities market. Just like today, the problem is, so that mainland capital will flow into Hong Kong to be laundered, so that mainland can make more money from Hong Kong, so that their cost of laundering money can be transferred to Hong Kong and for them to gain even more in the process. That is what we have ended up with, the so-called IPOs. That's for the purpose of financing. Mr. President, of course, you won't go buy these stocks unless you get insider news. Say I deal with rare earth on the mainland. How can we inquire into that? It's a scam. The SFC cannot do anything. The Hong Kong X aims to have more business, so it approves more vetting. What kind of a system is this, Mr. President? We cannot do anything, even if we know this is happening. And we cannot face the gamblers. Now, of course, if they are gamblers, we don't need to take care of them. Say, if they want to bet on a horse, we'll say, look, you shouldn't bet on it because it has a very narrow margin of winning. The thing is, like what the administration is saying, we need more offices, we need grade A offices and hotels, and we are going to make huge profits. Well, if you only look for profits but not regulate the market, then everybody would lose. You say you want to compete with Singapore. Where is competition? MPCSC can interpret the basic law anytime, and then no one can say anything. You teach judges to look to the north, so they know what to do and what not to do. Frankly, even if people want to gamble, they won't gamble in Hong Kong. So it's very simple, Mr. President. This Legislative Council works for the benefit of the rich and famous on the mainland. I can bet nobody dares touch Hong Kong X. Mr. Charles Lee is an American, but his blood is renminbi blood. So, Mr. Christopher Cheung, if you belong to the pro-establishment camp, you have to swallow this. No one sympathizes with you. This is how you get your seat here. I want to say something fair on your behalf, but it doesn't work. Thank you, President.
有没有其他议员想发言？
梁國雄議員，如果你要提規程問題，請你戴翻個麥先好。係，多謝主席，我應該戴麥嘅，呢個都係規程問題，戴麥唔應該講嘢。嗱，我認為基本上第75條裏邊咧，規定本會嘅開會嘅人數咧係要一半，我認為呢度咧係遠遠不及一半嘅一半嘅一半。
還有沒有其他議員想發言?
Does any member wish to speak?
張華峰議員,
Mr. Christopher Cheung, you may now speak on Mr. James Ho's amendment. The speaking time limit is 5 minutes. President. Ms. James To moved an amendment. He added three main elements to my original motion. One, to ensure that the SEHE has no conflict of roles between vetting and approval listings and marketing, and two, the government should review the existing regulatory legislation to combat any illegal activities, and three, to plug loopholes in regulation. So basically, he's going in the right direction as my original motion. There have been voices in the market that Hong Kong X is both a vetter and regulator, and there's a conflict of roles. Even though the listing fees only constitute a small part of their proceeds, and the listing committee is independent of Hong Kong X, so such claims are reasonable to some extent. And the market is full of cheating shares. The SFC and Hong Kong X are to blame, and something must be done to rectify the situation. And on the crackdown of illegal or improper behavior, I support the idea. Hong Kong has close links with the mainland, and shares with a Chinese background constitute more than 60% of our securities market. If there are illegal or improper behaviors in the mainland, the SFC cannot launch investigations. They have to go through the SRC. And in the past, some companies could not overcome the problems after a few years, and the investors suffered. And after the implementation of the Shanghai Hong Kong Stock Connect, we will implement the Hong Kong Shenzhen Stock Connect soon. And investors in Hong Kong and the mainland would be closer linked. And some unverified rumors are being spread on Weibo from time to time about the penny shares. A few weeks ago, the CSRC announced a violation, which was a case of share price manipulation. So cooperation between authorities in mainland and China and Hong Kong would instill confidence in investors and promote healthy market development. The last part of Mr. James To's amendment talked about enhancing transparency of SFC's regulatory work. In the previous term, I received a number of complaints against the CSRC. Some traders received complaints from small investors that they said the SFC is like an endless pit, and if you want to know about the progress of investigation, it's very difficult. The only choice is to offer information to the SFC, but if you ask the SFC, and they would cite confidentiality provisions in the SNF ordinance. And I know a director which used to be investigated by SFC, and 3 years passed, and there was no progress with the investigation, and he didn't know whether he would be prosecuted, but his reputation was already tarnished and his work was affected. And such scenarios were not ideal. I hope the SFC can review the situation and keep up with global trends and enhance transparency in regulation. I support Mr. James To's amendment regulation motion. Thank you.
Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury. President, I'm grateful to members for their valuable comments. We listened hard and long to their speeches and SFC and Hong Kong X will pay particular attention to what members said and give them due considerations. I gave some preliminary responses at the beginning of the debate and will now reply specifically to comments made during the debate. This morning, at a question time, Mr. Kenneth Leung had a question on shelf stocks and also cheating stocks. And some members were also concerned about this aspect of the market, saying that in terms of enforcement and gatekeeping, that is opposed to post and pre-listing, in formulating policies, we should do a better job. Yes, we agree to this. Some members expressed concern about the purpose of the consultation. Is the intention to give more powers to SFC so that it will see its power inflated? Mr. James To and Mr. Kenneth Leung both mentioned that under the current legislation, SFC already has the veto power over listing applications. Under Section 24 of the SFO, SFC can reject listing rules and also amendment to the listing rules. And under Section 6 of listing rules, SFC also enjoys certain powers. The consultation focuses on the decision-making process, and that is to allow SFC to be involved at the earlier stage of a listing application. This is not to usurp the power of Hong Kong X in frontline monitoring, because SFC already has the power to ask questions and make comments on all listing applications. And it can also easy notices indicating its intended objection to an application. And some applications were also vetoed by SFC. We have seen cases where after views and questions were raised by SFC, applicants withdrew their applications on a voluntary basis. And sometimes their applications just lapsed before the deadline. So under the current arrangements, we already allow SFC a final say in listing applications. So we're not giving excessive power to the commission. Some members expressed concern about the board of Hong Kong X. Individual board members have expressed opposition to the proposals. I'd like to say that the joint consultation paper was published after detailed discussion between senior members of SFC and Hong Kong X. So both organizations supported the public consultation. Both SFC and Hong Kong X, as well as the government, maintain an open mind in consulting the market. And some members asked whether the timetable was too tight. We didn't give enough time for the market and members of this council to consider the proposals. In fact, I said we extended the consultation period so that it lasted 5 months to allow ample time for the market to respond. Regarding Mr. James To's amendment that our listing policies should ensure that there is no conflict of interest between vetting and approval listings, Mr. Charles Moore, Mr. Kok-wai Keung, and Mr. Kenneth Leung wanted us to ensure that there is no conflict of roles as well. So they support this, and we also support this. The Hong Kong and Mr. To wants us to ensure public interest. Section 2.1 of SFO requires that recognized exchanges should have the interests of the investor, public investors, in mind when there is a conflict of interest between the vetting and approval listing and marketing role, then priority should be given to the protection of investors' interests. There was also a memorandum of understanding signed between SFC and Hong Kong X in 2003. It contains a clear division of labor with regard to their respective roles. Some members mentioned time again that as Hong Kong X is both a regulator and a market player. The consultation document has this proposal, and that is the chief executive of Hong Kong X should no longer be a member of LC to avoid possible conflict of roles or to give that impression. We also propose that the chief executive of Hong Kong X be a member of LPC so that he can participate in policy making of marketing. And for the LPC and NRC, they will have to make public the decisions to enhance transparency and to allow public scrutiny as far as their decisions are concerned. I'm sure these measures will, to a certain extent, extend to address the possible impression that there is conflict of roles on the part of SEHK. Mr. Christopher CHEUNG said that when it comes to protecting investors' interest, we should promote financial innovation. Mr. James TO said that we should review existing relevant regulatory legislation and to strengthen cooperation with the mainland regulatory authorities to combat any cross-boundary illegal activities and market misconduct carried out through the flow of funds. And some members talked about our market quality. We do take note that there are views in the market. By enhancing enforcement, we can deal with problems of market quality. In fact, when it comes to fundraising, Hong Kong has done very well. We are the envy of many parties. However, we should not just focus on the number of companies listed and capital raised. We have to ensure the quality of our market. This is most important. We noticed that there are more complaints against market malpractice or misconduct of companies, and SFC has enhanced its determination in cracking down on disclosure issues, and the number have doubled from 21 to 2015, and for formal hearings, there's been an increase of 50% in the number of cases. This shows that the conduct of listing companies is an important thing which we should address. I want to stress that SFC has carried out various enforcement activities to crack down illegal activities. In 2011, there were 311 investigations, and that is the double of 2012, and enforcement is only taken after there is misconduct and a loss on the part of investors. Therefore, we must play a better role in terms of gatekeeping and improving market quality so that we can protect the investors' public and enhance the confidence of both local and overseas investors and to maintain our reputation as a world financial center. So we should tackle problems before they emerge. For instance, Hong Kong X has tightened the regulation of listed companies, and there are a number of guidelines on issuers, on also companies that are shell companies, and there are guidelines on suitability of these issuers to be listed. There is also cooperation with SFS to review all the listing policies. The Growth Enterprise Board should be reviewed, and the long-time suspension of listing, so on and so forth, should all be reviewed. We are a signature to a multilateral agreement of IOSCO. The IOSCO has a joint cooperation mechanism for investigation of cross-boundary cases, and I think the result has been satisfactory. With connection of Hong Kong and local and mainland markets. We have strengthened cooperation with mainland regulatory authorities. The memorandum of understanding sets out provision that there can be information sharing, mutual support, and in investigation. And when there is enforcement action, we will ensure that there is investor interest protection for both local and mainland investors. In 2005, the SFO was amended so that we can assess the regulatory bodies of the mainland and other places, so that we can sign MOUs, and at the request of other regulators, we can provide a certain amount of assistance. We should also step up education of investors to help them make informed and appropriate choices. And when there are financial disputes, there should be effective ways of resolution. The Investors Education Center has enhanced the public publication to increase the public's information and knowledge and skills in finance management so that they can manage their finances properly. The Dispute Resolution Center will go for mediation before arbitration, providing independent, expeditious way to resolve conflicts between financial institutions and customers. Mr. James To proposed in his amendment that we should enhance the transparency of the work of SFC. In fact, since its establishment the SFC has maintained independent role as an oversight body. So all checks and balances available to public bodies are available to SFC. There are also other mechanisms, internal administrative procedures, and also procedures review panel, and also SFC appeals tribunal are applicable to SFC. The procedures review committee will look at the internal operation and guidelines of SFC to ensure that they are appropriate, and suggestions will be made to improve its operation. The committee will give annual reports and recommendations for help SFC to exercise its regulatory powers in a fair and impartial manner. This has also helped to enhance the transparency and accountability of the commission. Interested parties can make applications for review of decision by SFC, and the tribunal is set up under the relevant ordinance and chaired by a serving or retired judge. Currently, the chairman is a non-permanent judge of CFA, supported by two lay members. Licensing, disciplinary sanctions, and notices or decisions of SFC that can be subject to a review by this body, and the decisions are also open. Mr. James would like us to enhance the transparency of enforcement action without prejudice to the work of SFC, and to ensure that there is not against the principles, this can be done. Usually, after investigation, if there is any enforcement disciplinary decisions, SFC will issue press releases to explain its action. Mr. Christopher Chung and Mr. Charles Pong raised concern about healthy and orderly development of our securities market and to actively promote financial innovation. In fact, we've launched a lot of innovative measures to promote our development and to strengthen Hong Kong's position as an international financial and fundraising center. In 2014, we had the Hong Kong Shanghai Connect, and next Monday we have the Shenzhen Hong Kong Connect, and they represent important milestones for opening up of the capital accounts of the country. They provide additional investment choices for investors, and they offer potential for business opportunities for financial intermediaries. They will also protect Hong Kong as a premier offshore center of renminbi business. In 2015, there is the mutual recognition of funds between Hong Kong and the mainland. And as the first mutual fund recognition mechanism, and this will offer more choices for the fund sector, will bring business opportunities to the fund sector, and it will enhance Hong Kong's competitiveness as a major financial center. With the Road and Belt Initiative, we believe we can work in the following four areas. We can be a major investment and fundraising center for the Belt and Road Initiative. We can also be a hub for RMB business. We can be enhance our services as an asset management center, and we can also be a platform for Islamic financial services. This will bring business opportunities for us to ensure our fund management business is more diversified. In June, we passed a relevant bill to introduce a new structure so that fund companies can have an open structure in its incorporation. They can also be more flexible in its constitution so that investors can have more flexible arrangement in fund prescription, subscription, and redemption. This will enhance our attractiveness so that it will be more attractive for the funds to be incorporated in Hong Kong than overseas. Some members talk about a setup of a third board. SFC and Hong Kong X are reviewing our venture board, our GEM, a growth enterprise market. We will study the possibility of encouraging more enterprises to operate in Hong Kong, and they will consult the public in due course. To support the development of fintech, FS, in this year's budget, announced a number of measures. The administration and regulators and stakeholders are cooperating very closely to promote the implementation of these measures. For instance, SFC and other regulators have set up there's a dedicated platform for fintech to enhance communication with the market. In early November, we had the first fintech week. We had a number of roadshows, workshops, and exhibitions of new products to show showcase Hong Kong's unique position in this sector. A member mentioned that Asian Institute of International Finance had three, Douglas Ackler, and also two professors have expressed their views from a legal point of view on the proposals in the document. Yes, we've noted the publication of the document. Whether we have worked against the law, well, when we have studied all the issues, I'm sure the SFC and Hong Kong X will give full consideration to such views. Once again, I'd like to thank members for their valuable comments on the joint consultation for decision-making and governance structure for listing regulation. We will closely monitor the market situation. SFC and Hong Kong X have not formed any conclusion on the way forward yet. They maintain an open mind. And when analyzing these views, I believe by the end of next quarter, the earliest they'll be able to complete their analysis and will report to the council their views. Regarding views expressed by members, the government will continue to work hard in promoting our position as an international financial market and a hub of regional RMB business. Thank you.
And I'll put the question to you, and that is that the amendment moved by Mr. James To to Mr. Christopher Cheung's motion be passed. Will those in favor please raise your hands? Those against, please raise your hands. I think the question is agreed by majority respectively of each of the two groups of members who are present. I declare the amendment passed. Mr. Christopher Cheung, you still have 12 seconds to reply. The debate will come to a close after Mr. Christopher Cheung has replied. Mr. Christopher Cheung. President, I'd like to thank the 17 members for their comments and speeches. I now put the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Mr. Christopher Cheung as amended by Mr. James To be passed. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Mr. Dennis Kwok claims a division. The bell will be rung for 5 minutes.
開始表決.
Voting begins. Please verify your votes. Voting is closed. The results are displayed. For the FCs, 31 present, 29 for, 1 against, 0 abstention. From the geographical constituencies, 25 present, 22 for, 1 against, 2 abstentions. The question is agreed by majority respectively of each of the two groups of members present. I declare the motion passed.